رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي امري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقهوا قولي. O my Lord, open my chest for me and make my task easy for me and untie the knot of my tongue so that they understand my speech. This was a dua that Musa alayhi salam used to do. And incidentally, it has happened that about 2 days back, I have talked about the modern advances in arthroscopic sports medicine at Pune, that was on 19th, and today I'm speaking about the spiritual aspect of our medical science. As we all know, Islam is the most comprehensive religion, and medical science is the part and parcel of our daily life. Early Muslims could delve into science just because they had followed the inherent teachings of Islam, that is Quran and the Sunnah. And for 1,000 years, Muslims remained most developed because they adhered to the fact that Islam stressed the importance of learning, forbade destruction, followed authority, discipline and tolerance for other religions. And today's European Renaissance particularly owes a great deal to the Islamic scholars. And there have been multiple inscribed books, encyclopedias written by the Muslim scholars of all the time. This is acknowledged by scientists and historians even of today's time, although to a lesser level. Muslims predominantly carried the torch of science in the age when no other nation was capable of doing that. The early Muslims, of course, it started all from Islam. Prophet Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam came into existence, came as a Rasul, that's a messenger, and he made knowledge compulsory for each and every Muslim, male and female, unlike what today people think. The first ayah of Surah Alaq, Iqra bismi rabbika alladhi khalaq, so it started from read, and you all know what it means. Now, what we are taught usually is that there was Greek period, there was Roman period, and then there was a dark age. Is it possible that there was a dark age? In the coming slides, we will come to know as to what was dark age for the Europeans, was the golden age for the Muslims. Unfortunately, we finished the 360-degree cycle, and we are again back to bottom today, and we need to really take inspiration. It is not that we need to just be happy what we did behind, but we need to take inspiration from what has been done by our predecessor and what we really inherently have in us. And we need to exploit that feeling, exploit that intelligence, and exploit the community advantage that we have and the guidelines that we have in Quran and Sunnah to again go on the top. In the past, before Islam ruled the world, the Christian rulers, basically these were the religious people, and they always prosecuted all the scientists that nothing of this kind should be done. And these people flew from their areas and came into the Muslim ruled land, and that was the beginning of the knowledge era for the Muslims. And later on, after they saw Muslims becoming best in all the areas of knowledge, including science, technology, and the military, everything, the West also embraced it. Unfortunately, over the period of time, as we all know, we lost it. After the time of Jahiliyyah, now let us start from the period of Hudud Prasam. Prophet Muhammad Prasam himself acted as a successful physician and prescribed the ways of healing to his companions, predominantly by three means: honey, cupping, cauterization, the latter not been really liked by him because of the pain to the patient due to lack of anesthesia at that time. However, the faith of Muslims in the ahadith of Prophet Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, that there is always a cause and cure for every disease, as we all say that har marz ka ilaj hai, that faith made the encouragement in the early Muslims to engage in biomedical research and seek out cure for each and every disease that existed then. Their main contribution to begin with was to convert the books of knowledge from all the parts of the world into Arabic text, which Muslims understood the best. So there was Chinese medicine, Chinese scripture converted into Arabic, the Sanskrit scripture converted into Arabic, the Hebrew scripture, the Persian scripture, the Latin one, everything got converted into Arabic language, and that was the beginning of the Muslim scientists. And they capitalized on the previous teachers like Hippocrates, Galen, etc. However, they did not follow blindly. Now, this one small thing I would like to stress upon what Muslims had in them was tahqeeq. So everything has to be followed. Like there is a ahadith that if a person comes with a blind eye and says that this person has done it, do not directly question him. Just go into tahqeeq whether really he has done it. So that tahqeeq, even if we see the formation of sahih ahadith, the stressful and the most difficult criteria through which these ahadith were put through. So all these things acted as a reference system. This reference system came into existence from these points in the history. And thereby, this was converted into an entirely new science. It did not just remain as hearsay.
Reference of Ibn Sina. His full name, it's a tongue twisting, so we would call him Ibn Sina, and more tongue twisting for the West, who call them Avicenna. He was from Bukhara, Uzbekistan in the 10th century. Now, he's called the father of medicine. His name goes in fluency, Hippocrates, Galileo, and Avicenna. So that's what they call it. We know that he was a Muslim. I too came to know at a later date when I actually went into all this. I just thought it must be some Greek person. He introduced the systematic experimentation and quantification into the study of physiology. He discovered contagious. Now, whatever I'm speaking, you can see the small. Unfortunately, these lights. Can we just switch off these lights? I want you to see what I'm speaking, because I'm not speaking just offhand. There are references down there. So there is a number up, and you can see the references. If anybody wants, you will get this slide show so that you can actually confirm what I'm speaking. So everything is reference that I'm speaking. So as introduction of systematic experimentation and quantification into the study of physiology, he discovered contagious nature of the infectious diseases, introduced the method of quarantine. You know what is quarantine, quarantine that Arab people say. It's the method of quarantine where the diseased people, the infected people, are kept in one part of the society so that they don't spread the disease to the normal individuals. So he was the one to bring that into existence. Introduction of experimental medicine and evidence-based medicine, clinical trials, randomized controlled trials. He did efficacy tests and clinical pharmacology. He was also into neuropsychiatry. Risk factor analysis and idea of syndrome came with him. Of course, as an early person, everybody does errors, so there must be errors in his way, but he put across the method for the people to come as to how to go about medical science. He's also considered as father of fundamental concepts of momentum in physics. So we are just talking about medicine now, pioneer of aromatherapy. George Sadon, who is considered the father of history, says that one of the most famous exponents of Muslim universalism and the eminent figures in Islamic learning was Ibn Sina, known to the West as Avicenna. His most important medical works are Qanun. Qanun is what we call law. They call it canon because they cannot really pronounce it. And the treatise of cardiac drugs. Qanun fi al-tibb is an immense encyclopedia of medicine. And there's a reference, you can check that down. Now, this book, Qanun fi al-tibb, was 14 volumes. There are people who have published their papers, 4 or 5 page paper, it takes months to write and to. Imagine a person writing 14 volumes. So it's not like today what our assistants and there are people who are contributing to the chapter. He had written it all by his own. So 14 volumes, and it was a standard medical text in Europe and Islamic world until 19th century. He was known for his introduction of physiology, contagious nature of diseases, quarantine. These all were things. Why is he known? Because he's written that into the books. And he also hypothesized the possibility of microorganisms. Unfortunately, that time microscope was not had not still come, but he hypothesized that there must be some microorganisms which are causing this. And believe me, it has been very tough for me to put this into a half an hour lecture. Each one whom I am speaking about deserves at least 3 hours of lecture. Only then we give little justice to that person who has done extensive amount of work. And we are talking about 10th century, that is about 1100 years from now. Before. Then is Al-Tabri. He is again the 9th century physician. He was the teacher to Al-Razi, whom they call Rhesus. He wrote his book, Paradise of Wisdom, that is Firdaus Al-Hikmah, in 234 after Hijri. 360 chapters, out of which 36 chapters were dedicated to Indian medicine. Then this great man, Al-Razi, whom they call Rhesus. He was Tabari's student, a great clinical observational physician of all the time. He, along with Ibn Sina, was most influential in East as well as the West. He became director of his hospital in his native place first, and then the hospital in Baghdad, and there were so many students from the West who used to come and take teachings from him. His book, Al-Jadariwa Al-Hasba, was the first book describing smallpox and measles, and was translated in more than a dozen Latin and other European languages. He is known for having discovered as allergic asthma. I'm sure everybody can see this with these lights on. Can everybody see this? Yep. He was the first to realize that fever is a defense mechanism for fighting the diseases. He wrote multiple books, about 53 they say. Few of his books are there till date. Al-Razi himself recorded some of the most unusual cases encountered during his medical practice, thereby giving him a big name in even the present day physiology. His books, a few of them is Al-Hawi, which has got 9 volumes, and it is a large comprehensive. In Europe, it was also the large comprehensive or the continent liber. Contains considerations and criticism on Greek. So here, in his independent thinking, he used to also criticize the previous authors, what they had done wrong. And that's how the science evolves. And this book alone makes him the greatest physician of all the time. Remember, we are talking about 1,000 years before this. More than 1,000 years. And then it was Manla Yahrudu Al-Tabib. Then there was Shukuk Al-Jalinus. So there were certain mistakes in Galen's literature, which he pointed out by his independent mind. And he was the first person to write a separate book in the world on diseases of children, thereby making him the first pediatrician of the world. Abu Rayhan Muhammad Ibn Al-Biruni. This man, again, 1,000 years back, he wrote Kitab al-Sayyidina fi al-Tib, which was extensive medical and pharmacological encyclopedia which synthesized Islamic medicine and the Indian medicine. He described earliest Siamese twin. He had in-depth botanical studies of mineral and herb, earliest to describe several fungi. Then Ibn al-Baythar. Imagine the number of people and see at the photographs. I'm going to ask you what common thing that you found in these photographs. Was from Spain and wrote these two books. He is called Botanical Authority for centuries. He was called for centuries for listing 1400 plants and drugs, 300 being his own discoveries. And his book was used until 19th century by the Europe. Al-Kindi, who is called Al-Kindus, is from Kufa, Baghdad, known for his effort to introduce Greek and Hellenistic philosophy in the Arab world. He was the first to demonstrate application of mathematics and quantification of medicine, particularly in the field of pharmacology. And he got several treatises. He initiated several treatments for epilepsy and other diseases. Ibn Rushd, who is also called Averroes, from Andalusia, now Spain. He again wrote a book. See, all these people, one thing common is they have written book. They have written a book for the people to follow, which we need to follow, which means we have to go into the research. Kulliyat, okay? The Latin translation collegiate is very, very well known. He also wrote commentary on the Kanun Fiyal Tib of Ibn Sina. In urology, he was the first to identify the issues of sexual dysfunction and erectile dysfunction, and also showed certain treatments for those problems that time. Ibn Jazzar, again the 10th century person, he wrote Kitab al-Adwiya al-Mafrada, which was translated into Greek, Latin, etc. But his Constantine, that the Latin translation Gibber de Gadribus, was the first of the special importance and was very much popular among the West. Again, he wrote Tib al-Fuqara wal-Masakin, the medicine for the poor. Ibn al-Nafis, a 12th century physician and scientist. He worked in Al-Nasri Hospital, Al-Mansuri Hospital, and then became the chief of physician. I'm very sorry for the monotonous thing, but we need to describe, we need to really tell about these people who had been scholars and not learnt, unfortunately, in our present day medical curriculum. Ibn Zuhr, or Ibn Zuhr, or Abu Mehran, or Ibn Zuhr, as he is called. He was the teacher of Averroes, that's Ibn Rushd. Now you are reading it very correct, the one which I have highlighted. He was the first person to think about parenteral nutrition with a silver needle. You read it right. The first person to think of giving parenteral nutrition for human beings by silver needle, which in today's era, none of the surgery can take place without that particular way of treatment. In the field of physiology, again we find Al-Razi, Ibn Nafis. Now just I would spend some time on this. Now Ibn Nafis has described circulation about few centuries before the West came to know. However, we are told that the first person to describe circulation was somebody else. On pulmonary circulation, read this, I'm reading this, just pay attention on what it is written. The blood from right chamber of the heart must arrive to the left chamber of the heart, but there is no direct pathway between them. The thick septum of the heart does not perforate, and he had not dissected, does not perforate and does not have similar visible pores as some people thought, or invisible pores as Galen had thought. The blood from right chamber must flow through the arteria venosa, that is the pulmonary artery, to the lungs, spread through the substance, be mingled with the air, pass through the arteria venosa into the pulmonary vein, to reach the left chamber of the heart, and then from there to the vital spirit. Can you imagine somebody about a thousand, a millennium back had thought about the anatomy of lungs? He said the lungs are composed of parts, one of which is bronchi, the second, the branches of arteria venosa, the third, and the branches of vena arteriosa. Now all of them connected by loose porous flesh. He's talking about alveoli. There was no microscope available. He was thinking that the air gets mingled. That means the oxygen is getting mingled with the blood, so that the person remains alive. On coronary circulation, again he has made statements. Because of want of time, I'm not going into each and every statement. Even about he thought about precursor of capillary circulation, and all of them have been referenced. You can check those references. Ibn Zuhr gave the first accurate description of neurological disorders, included meningitis, intracranial thrombophlebitis, etc. In pharmacy, again the same names come up. Al-Razi used mercurial ointments, he developed mortars, flasks, spatulas, phials. Ibn Sina used ice for fever. He separated medicine from pharmacology. Now this man is one of my favorites. We'll talk about him just in the later slide. Abu al-Qasim al-Zahrawi, who's called Albucasis, who's from Spain in the 10th century, and many other scientists. How many minutes are there? Oh no, it's 30 minutes, no? Yeah. In anatomy, we will just go back on this. This Yohanna al-Miswa, he procured monkeys for the book of anatomy and he dissected them and wrote about anatomy. He was such a person that he wanted to dissect his own son, but the Khalifa of that time did not allow him to do that. Now this man, Abu al-Qasim al-Zahrawi, is considered the father of modern surgery. Out of the most important is his Kitab al-Tasrif. These are the images that I have got. He wrote 30 volumes of surgery. His use of catgut even is used in today's medicine, and he thought about surgical needle, which he invented and described. His surgical instruments are still there. Ibn Haytham was the best in optics and today's ophthalmology. He did experiments on optics, including experiments on lenses, refraction, etc., and constitutions of the colors. Regarding hospital, Baghdad had its first hospital in 850 AD. By 10th century, doctors had to pass an exam to treat the people. And there were multiple hospitals outside. Now, are we honest really and justified in describing that glorious period as dark ages? It was dark for somebody else, not for us. So, today we can go back and go to the basics and do the things. Now, the decline, there are several people giving several theories. What I feel why decline is because we left the Khaliq and went after the makhluk. It's like Payadharma. Rather than individually treating each and every abscess that is coming to the community, go back to the root cause, give an antibiotic to it, and all the Payadharma abscesses will go away. So in conclusion, what we need to do is focus on our religion and attach to it, hold it firmly with our incisor teeth, follow the Quran and Sunnah, be honest and unbiased in research. Do not neglect everything that is coming from the West. Take that is good without taking their cultural aspect. Develop yourself in different branches. Keep the eyes open. Remember, the present day 1, 2, 3, 4 numbering system is come into existence by, this is an Arabic script which I came to know very long back till the time I actually published an international paper. By the way, I got 7 minutes more. I had to publish my first paper in Indian Journal of Orthopedics. There was a hand surgery topic, and I was going through the rules of the journal, and I came to know that it is written right into Arabic script. The numbering should be in Arabic. I didn't know why they are asking for Arabic numbering system, because what I knew till then is numbering Arabic is the one which they are writing, the Persian script, which I went into details, and I actually came to know that today's present day 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, what we write in English is this numbering system, which is actually the Arabic numbering system, which we have given and we have left it. In all the aspects, we find that. Now, a few papers that I actually found. Now, multiple modern day studies are reinforcing our sunnah. Now, few of them, I will just say, the preoperative nasal decolonization. What happens in joint replacement surgery, there is about less than 1% chances of infection. There are researchers who found out that this bacteria was existingly present in the nose or other mucosa of the body, thereby causing this infection about 87% of the times. So there are people who started to decolonize the nasal. That is, 5 days before surgery, they start applying nasal ointment, T-Bac, what we call mucosal ointment, in the nasal mucosa. That reduced, according to several, I quoted two papers, there are several papers on that, anywhere between 30% to 60% less chances of infection they have found retrospectively in the trial of people who were given nasal and who were not given. And I have caused this. Now, I feel that we require to do a study in the group of people who do not pray 5 times daily and who pray 5 times daily. Those people, this is my thinking, and every paper comes from a thinking. So those people who are actually cleaning their nose 5 times daily, I feel that the chances of bacteria colonizing in the nasal mucosa will be less. So we've got a task ahead. There are people here, there are people from multiple cities. We can have a randomized double-blind study. And we can have 500 swabs from people who are not cleaning their nose 5 times daily and 500 from the swabs and culture them and see. An unbiased study, maybe we will be able to prove more better things and we'll be able to have our iman more stronger, inshallah. Now there's one study that was taken place, that had taken place in the US, UK. Bearded surgeons are three times more hygienic. Now this is some good. The surgeons who keep a beard are three times more hygienic. They took the swab of surgeons from the cheek. Those people who had got about 430, I suppose they took. I've kept the link over there. You can just click it and find it on the net. It's just in 2016 they had done, and they found that bearded surgeons' face is three times more cleaner as compared to non-bearded surgeons. And we want to follow them. The necktie is to be banned in the hospitals due to high risk of infection. And now, at present day, I came to know that in UK, the surgeons are not allowed to wear their necktie because that is the biggest source of infection today. And what do we want to do? We want to follow blindly. Islam doesn't allow following blindly. All the people that I showed just now never ever followed. Yes, they took things from them, but they did not follow them blindly. They had their checks and balances. That is how the administration and the spiritual as well as the medical part of Islam works. And that is what we need to do. We need to learn the Quranic Arabic. Now, why am I saying this is in actual continuation of my lecture, and I'm sure I've got a couple of minutes more, so I can always speak about them. If we know the Arabic language, if we read just the translation of it, we will not get the gist of it. Many a times the translator might have missed because you cannot get 100% translation. So if we know the Arabic grammar, Quranic Arabic grammar, I was sitting with a great man, Dr. Khaliq, Abdul Khaliq from Delhi. And he is the Arabic scholar, he is a teacher of Arabic. He just made the last slide which I will be displaying. So when we know the language, we will be able to procure from Quran, like embryology, like pain receptors are in skin. There are each individual is made up of different fingertips. This is all given in Quran. I have quoted the verse, so you can go and see them. The forehead, in Surah Alaq itself, Allah Ta'ala says that regarding Abu Jahl, that if he does not desist, he will surely drag him with a forelock, that is the forehead. A lying, sinning forelock, which means that the planning happens in the forehead, and that is already there in the Quran, isn't it? And we know it now from our medical science literatures. We need to avoid this, of course. And one thing before concluding, I would like to say, I've just made these concluding slides a couple of minutes back. Revolution is not brought by majority. It is brought by committed minority. And remember, we are those committed minorities. We need to do the best that we can do in the field of science, medical science, and all the other places. وَمَا عَلَيْنَا إِلَّا الْبَلَاغُ الْمُبِينَ I thank you very much for your